Okay. Yeah. Yes. So now what happened in the beginning was, in the year 1600 AD, the company, see, in Europe, there were various companies. You already know about the Industrial Revolution. Okay. So during those time, even in England, there were various companies which wanted to trade with, you know, go across the world and find out places where they can acquire raw material and sell their finished goods also. Okay. Now, the East India Company acquired a charter from the Queen of England that they will have a monopoly, that it will be only the East India Company which will trade with the Eastern countries. Eastern countries means China, India, okay, Southeast Asian countries. They got the charter from the Queen of England, which means that no other company in England was allowed to come to East and trade with India or any other Eastern country. Okay, so which year it was? 1600 AD. Okay, let me tell you, even after getting the charter, it was in the year 1608 that they were able to come to India and begin the trade. Okay, you can note it down in your notebook also. In the year 1608, they reached India and they began the trade. Initially, they acquired the charter, but it took few years for them to finally establish trade relations with India. Okay, and initially there was no competition with other companies in England. Okay, so why did they acquire the charter from the Queen of England? So that no other company is allowed to trade with any other country on the Eastern front. I hope this is clear to everyone. Any doubt here, children? Yes?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No, ma'am.
This is the beginning of the first section, how it started. I talked about the revolt of 1857, but that happens in the end, by the middle of the second half of the 19th century. But here we are coming back. We are starting the story from which year? From the year 1600, which means the beginning of the 17th century. Okay, so in this particular lesson, we are going to cover the entire 17th century and we are going to cover the entire 18th century. I hope this makes it clear to you. And then eventually in the upcoming lessons, we will look at the 19th century and the revolt of 1857 also. Any doubts or any questions, children, you can ask me. You can send messages on the chat also. Yeah? Okay. Also, other European companies and their rivalry with the East India Company over trade with India. So now, just like England had their own company, the East India Company, it was British. Okay. Similarly, there were other countries also. Can you tell me a few other countries which were also in the competition with the East India Company to compete for the trade relations? Can you let me know any other company or of any other country in Europe? Who others were coming to India? Who was the person who discovered India? And which country did he belong to? Please raise
Marco Polo.
Marco Polo is far
Marco
back.
Marco Polo.
Far back. We are talking about trade here. He was a traveler.
Vasco da Gama.
Yes, it was Vasco da Gama. Can you tell me Vasco da Gama belonged to which country? He came to India in the year 1498, which means he came to India in the 15th century only. So the Britishers were very late. Britishers and the French were the last to visit India. Before that, we mainly speak about the trade with India. It was mainly... Initially, the first country to come to India for trade was the Portuguese. Because Vasco da Gama was the one who discovered India in 1498. That is, 1498 is the end of the 15th century. And 16th century, they began trade with India. So, the first country which began trade with India were the Portuguese. Why? Why did it happen? I'm here specifically, children. Let me tell you, this is the trade through the sea. Especially when at that time also, the Industrial Revolution had not reached its peak. If we look at before that, We can talk about the Arabs who came to India maybe around 900 AD. They also initially, but that trade was through land. They came to India through land. They were not coming by sea. Only the Ottoman Empire, the traders from the Ottoman Empire, where you have the Muslim rule over there, the Arabs were coming to India through sea route before that. So the Arabs were the first, but we're not looking from that point of view here. And especially the other Europeans could come to India through the, you already know about the Silk Route also. So trade relations were there since the ancient period also. But here when we're talking about, especially about the later medieval period, it was the Portuguese who came to India for the first time. This topic is quite debatable because traders have been visiting India since the ancient period also. But here when we're talking about the later medieval period, it was specifically the first the Portuguese came, then the Dutch, then the French came in the by the end of the 18th century, they were the last, and the British came in the 17th century beginning, which means especially in 1608. Okay, 1600 they acquired the charter, and by the year 1608 they reached India. Any doubt or any questions here, children? Okay, so now I was talking to you about other European companies and their rivalry. Of course, when we're talking about rivalry in Europe, in England itself, there were so many companies. So East India Company was able to acquire the charter to monopolize trade with India. Similarly, from other countries like France, Portugal, Germany, Netherlands, from other countries, these traders were coming towards East, especially Africa and towards India and China, to establish trade relations. Why these trade relations were important? Please raise your hands and let me know. Please let me know. Yes. Please raise your hands. I hope you all are listening. Yes, why these trade relations were important? Shall I call out somebody's name to answer the question? Aditi Bhole, can you
for raw, yes. Ma'am, for raw material.
For raw material, why did they need the raw material?
To make products.
To make products also, and what else? Now they have made the products. There was
and to sell them.
Yeah, and they also came for selling those goods. Okay, so
they were forgetting those at lower price.
Yes, of course, they were selling their products and buying raw material at very very low rates. So this was entirely a profitable solution for them. Yes.
Ma'am, they could sell them in Europe in higher prices or
yes,
wherever
very good.
They could
sell those products at very high prices. So this was a win-win situation for the European companies to come and trade with India. Now, can you tell me what were the reasons for the rivalry between these companies? What could be the reasons?
There was a
competition. Of course, there is a win-win situation. When there is a profit making happening here,
over trade.
Yeah, over the trade. Everybody wants to monopolize, every company wanted to monopolize trade with India because it was very, very profitable. So there was a clash between many of the companies. Even wars used to happen between the Dutch and the English, between the French company and the East India, the French East India Company and the British East India Company. Similarly, the Portuguese company also had to wage wars. They had wars, and eventually regions in the south were acquired by the Dutch and the Portuguese companies also. But eventually, later on, it was the British which became the most powerful and was able to acquire the entire territory of India. So what were the reasons for the rivalry? The problem was that all the companies were interested in buying the same things. The fine qualities of cotton and silk produced in India had a big market in Europe. Okay, the first reason is that they all the companies were interested in buying things from India. Secondly, the quality of cotton and silk that was there, it was the best in India, and it had a big market in Europe. People were ready to buy this cotton and silk in India at very high price. Okay, similarly, some exotic spices like pepper, cloves, cardamom, cinnamon, these were only available in India at that time. No other country was selling these exotic spices. So they also had a that also led to the trade rivalry among the countries. Yes, anybody has a query here? Now, similarly, competition amongst the European companies inevitably pushed up the prices at which these goods could be purchased. Now, children, when we are talking about a market, suppose you if something is rare, it becomes very costly, isn't it? Yes. For example, if we look at gold or diamond jewelry, it is far more costlier than any other metal jewelry, isn't it? Why? What is the reason behind it? The reason is that it is very rarely available. So that is why these spices, cotton and silk was very rare for the European market. And because of the competition, the prices of these goods rose to very, very high. It was very, very, these things were very costly in Europe. And so that was one of the most important reasons for the rivalry among the European companies. Here in this particular slide, can you see the slide, children? Is it visible to you all? Is the slide visible to
everyone?
Yeah. So here you can see the trade relations. I was explaining you about the trade relations from here, from Portugal. From here Vasco da Gama came and he took this entire route and came to India. Yes, at that time Suez Canal was not there. We have studied that in the previous class also. So all the way from Europe to then reaching the Cape of Good Hope and then coming to India. So this was the trade route towards India, especially towards the East. Yes, I hope is there any doubt related to this map here? So this is the British Island. And from here, this is the St. Helena Islands are here. And from here, Cape of Good Hope, they touch the Cape of Good Hope. They used to stay here for a couple of months. And then again, they started their journey towards India. Okay. And this was the route for the Arabs. Okay. Here you had the Ottoman Empire, children. I was talking to you about the Ottoman Empire. I hope you can see the mouse. Yeah. See, here the Ottoman Empire was there earlier, before Vasco da Gama came to India through this route. Earlier, this was a silk route to China, India, and here Europe, till here, Rome, Italy. Okay, this route was through the land. Okay, before that, Suez Canal was not there. So most of the travelers, they used to travel all the way from here to India to trade. So this was the old silk route. But then, after Vasco da Gama found India, so this was initially the trade route through the sea, through water. Any doubts with the map, children?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No, ma'am.
We come to the next slide now. Okay. Now, who discovered, let's do this one activity here. Did you know who discovered India in the 15th century and when? Please raise your hands. Am I okay, Sanika? Yes, yes, Sanika.
Ma'am, Vasco da Gama.
Which year?
Ma'am, 1498.
Very good. It was 1498. Okay, we just have 10 minutes. Let's do a quick recap. Who were the first to trade with India?
Portuguese.
The Portuguese. Very good. When did the British and French came to trade with India? Yes, Sanika.
Ma'am, 17th century.
17th century, that's the beginning of the 17th century. 1608 is the year when the British arrived, and in the 18th century, the French came. French came very late, okay? So that was like synonymous, okay. Not synonymous. First the British and then the French, okay? So this was about how the trade relations started in India. I hope, is there any question here about the introduction of how the East India Company acquired the charter from the Queen of England for to monopolize trade in the East, and how what were the reasons of rivalry among the various companies, and how India was discovered, and who were the first traders with India. I've already explained that. And what were the reasons? Because of the high demand of Indian goods, Indian cotton, silk, and exotic spices. And what were the reason? And the competition among the companies led to the rise in prices of the goods purchased from India. Okay. So another thing was that the only way the trading companies could flourish was by eliminating their rival companies. The urge to secure markets therefore led to fierce battles between the trading companies. Through the 17th and the 18th centuries, they regularly sank each other's ships. So war used to happen and they used to sank each other's ships in the ocean. They used to blockade the routes. They used to block the routes to India through ocean. And also they prevented the rival ships from moving with the supplies of the goods from India. Okay, trade was carried on with arms and trading posts were protected through fortifications. So they started making their forts so that they can protect their goods, and they had their soldiers in the ships later on. This effort to fortify settlements and carry on profitable trade also led to intense conflict with local rulers. Not only that, there was a rivalry among the company, between the companies, but the local rulers of the country. We will come to that part. I will be elaborating on that by the late 18th century. Okay, so it was very difficult to separate trade from politics. So that led to politics, leading to politics in the trade relations among the companies and the local rulers of those countries. And when we're talking about India, again, the conflict was the main political parties, the main political kingdoms, the Britishers, they started having rivalry over some, for example, duty-free trade they wanted. They did not want to pay any kind of a duty before they enter inside in our country and do their trading. Yes, Samyak, you have a question. Yes, any questions here? We have just 6 minutes left, so let me just try and cover this part also. East India Company begins its trade. Initially, first it was Bengal, from where the East India Company started its trade. So the first factory, or you can say the first place from where the Britishers, the East India, started its trade in India was in, they set up a factory in 51, and where was the factory located? It at the banks of river Hooghly. Okay, this was the place where this initially first they only set up the factory. Okay, now with the expansion of trade and factories and offices, they inside the factories they used to store their goods in the warehouses. Also, they had their workers there. The British workers also, they had their own offices where they used to, you know, everyday calculations, everyday files were there. So they had their office also in the warehouses initially. So they were just these factories were for manufacturing of some kind of goods initially, or you know, acquiring goods, storage of goods was being done, and offices were there. But with the expansion of trade, it was required because of the rivalry, not only with the other companies of other countries, but with the local rulers. They required that they needed soldiers to protect them and their goods from the other rival local leaders and other companies also. So the expansion of trade and factories and offices to also led to the settling of merchants and traders to settle near the factories. They started settling near these factories so that comfortably they can conduct the trade. Okay, and they will be safe also because the soldiers were hired to in the fortress to protect the goods and the people and the merchants. And eventually factories got converted into fortresses. What is a fortress? Yes, Sanika, you have a question.
No, ma'am.
Okay. So eventually with the growing and expansion of trade and the merchants settling there, these factories got converted into fortresses. Fortress, what is a fortress? Where you have soldiers to protect people and property. Okay. Fortress is like you build a wall around the factory. A huge wall is being built so that you can protect the factory. Yes, Neha, you have a question? Any question here? Okay. Also, company acquired zamindari rights. Initially, they were not acquiring any territory, children. They were just here to conduct trade. So the first time the company realized that they need to acquire some territory also because they wanted to build fortresses for their keeping their goods, keeping their soldiers. So initially, they bribed some of the Mughal zamindars. They did some bribing. They paid some bribe. And what they did, they acquired zamindari rights in the three villages. And one of them was Kalikata, which was later came to be known as a city of, it became a city. And it currently it is known as, later on it came to be known as Calcutta. And now it is known as Kolkata. So initially it was a village, but then it developed so much that it became a city. And Kolkata became very much important for the East India Company. I hope till here everybody is clear. Any doubt here?
No, ma'am.
Okay, good. Now, another benefit the East India Company got was gradually with the growing trade and because it started becoming prosperous. During those time, Aurangzeb was the ruler of the Mughal Empire. He was the king at that time. So now they were able to persuade Aurangzeb, the emperor, to issue a farman. Do you know what is a farman? A farman is a royal edict or a royal order. Okay, now the emperor himself gave this order. What was the order? To allow the East India Company for a duty-free trade. What do you understand by duty-free trade? Can anybody tell me? You can give example from today's present scenario also. Suppose if you want to, you are a merchant of gold and you are residing in Maharashtra. And you want to carry that gold from Maharashtra to Madhya Pradesh. Do you think you have to pay any kind of a duty or tax when you are changing your state from Maharashtra to Madhya Pradesh?
No, ma'am.
Why no? Ma'am. You have to pay a tax, isn't it?
Ma'am, it is a duty tax.
Some kind of a duty is there. Now, we are not talking about the present times, currently the present government. You have the, now the taxes have been changed. But earlier it was, there was something known as the octroi. Isn't it? Yes. You had to pay octroi, some kind of a duty or some kind of a tax. You had to pay. You had to pay if you are carrying some valuables from one state to another. So you have to pay some tax. Similarly, the British East India Company was required to pay some kind of a duty to enter into India and conduct trade. And this tax, where did this tax go to? To the emperor's treasury, to the Mughal emperor's treasury. Isn't it? Yes, today also we have to pay taxes, isn't it? In today's times also, some kind of a tax via GST we are paying to the government, isn't it? I hope you all are with me.
Yes, ma'am.
Similarly, during those times, the British East India Company also has to pay when you are coming inside the country and when you are taking the goods and going outside the country. Both times you have to pay some kind of a duty fee. Okay, so now they persuaded Aurangzeb to allow them duty-free trade. Similarly, company also pressed for more concessions that led to enormous loss of revenue of Bengal. This way, there was a lot of loss which was incurred by the Nawab of Bengal, and the Nawab of Bengal at that time was Murshid Kuli Khan. Okay, children, we are running out of time now. We will continue with the same discussion in the next class now. Okay, this class is going to get over. Okay, and you can write down your doubts. I will answer your questions in the next class. Yes? Everyone with me here?